Who is
that on the radio?
Who is that on the radio?
Who is that on the radio?
You really want to know who's on the radio? Come on. Let's talk about it.
Jeffrey. Let's talk about it live with Jeffrey L. Miller. Watching is the best decision you'll ever make. Thursday nights from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. Eastern.
You know what time it is.
Call or text in live, 470-251-4647, # Let's Talk with Jeffrey. And come check us out on www.statusnetwork.net or download the Status Network app on your Apple or Google Play Store.
Let's give them something to talk about.
It's almost showtime, people.
Let's tune in to see what Jeffrey has in store for us tonight. And here is your host, Jeffrey L. Miller.
What is going on, Status Network, Manifest TV, Instagram, and Facebook, WhatsApp, all of those other applications? It's time for Let's Talk About It Live with Jeffrey L. Miller. Now, it's been a minute since I've done this, and usually we do it on Thursday, but we're going to show up and show out tonight on a Friday at 8 o'clock p.m. to 10 o'clock p.m. This is exactly how we're going to do it. Now, look, there's a whole lot of stuff going on right now in the world. There's a whole lot of political stories, a whole lot of entanglements going on out there in the world. But I wanted to do something a little different tonight. I wanted to get together with a lot of really, really powerful professional people. We always have professional people. Don't get it twisted on this show. And we want to talk about stuff with substance tonight. Stuff with substance. Now, I know a lot of stuff is going on and with Will and Jada and the Red Table in August. And, you know, August is the greatest month of the year, first of all. But that stuff is good. That's cool. We ain't going to talk about that tonight. We're going to talk about some serious stuff. So I got a number of guests with me. They're about to drop some knowledge on you and share some news you can definitely use today. First of all, I want to start off with one of my guests. I'd like to welcome Pamela Stewart to the show. Pamela, you with us? We got you on mute. Okay, good deal. Make sure you're not on mute for me, Pamela.
I'm not.
Okay, good deal. Good deal. Next up, we have Dr. Edmund Moore. Welcome to the show, sir.
Hey, thank you for inviting me.
Wonderful, wonderful. Looking forward to having a conversation today about a book that you have coming out. Oh, actually, that's already out. It's going to be a great conversation. Next up, we have right here to my right, from the Patterson Group.
Absolutely.
All right. Judge Patterson, how are you, sir?
Just fine. It's a pleasure to be here with you, Jeffrey. It really is.
Wonderful. Now, I need y'all to understand that I had to dress up a little bit because I knew he was going to come up in here sporting some stuff. But, you know, you got to rep when you're repping like this. Got to do it. Also, we have our good brother Gary on the line. Gary has a really, really important mission that he's satisfying and that he's taking care of. We're going to talk to him too in detail about what he's doing. Brother Gary, welcome to the show, sir.
Thank you, brother. It's good to be here.
Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. Now listen, I want everybody to understand something. We got a couple of traditions up in this piece. Now, first of all, it was hot as all get out outside. Amazingly, for a Friday, traffic wasn't that bad. My granddaughter told me that she loves me and she calls me the granddad. My daughter loves me. My son loves me. My mother loves me. All of that is good, but in spite of all those accolades, you know what time it is. It's time for you to close your mouth and listen. You ask me some questions, I give you some answers from a man's point of view. Now listen, I got one reason for the habitually single woman and one reason for the habitually single man as to why you might be single, but before we get into that, here is my disclaimer. Now, see, what I'm going to talk about may not apply to you. If it doesn't apply to you, I don't want you to put your foot up in this shoe. But if it does apply to you, I want you to put both feet in both shoes and walk around in them because you're about to learn something tonight. Now, ladies, you go first. All right, ladies. Some of y'all are single simply because you want to be heard, but you don't want to listen. I mean, you want your man to recognize everything that you are and accept you, flaws and all, in your fullness of everything that you've ever experienced in life. But you don't want to listen to him when he wants to express something he's not satisfied with. You don't have time for that conversation. Or You expect that man to understand exactly what it is you're feeling because he's just supposed to know. But when he expresses discontent towards something that you're having, you didn't know no better. Why didn't you tell me? Ladies, understand something now. I love y'all to death. This is coming from a space of love. But communication is not a one-way street. You have to make sure that you are communicating and listening to understand, and not just listening to be heard or listening to be right. Failure to do so, well, there might be the reason why you are single. Don't think because they've been on the radio for a while I wasn't gonna do that, ladies. Y'all know I was gonna bring that heat. Now, Pamela, don't worry. I'm gonna get your feedback, but I'd like to start with the fellas. Judge Patterson, what do you think about that? Why some women now might be single? Some women might be single?
Well, a couple of reasons. One is by choice. The other is that their standards could be a little bit too high, meaning that they're looking for the perfect gentleman, and there is no perfect gentleman. You have to be able to compromise.
I love it. Brother Gary, can I get some feedback from you, sir, as to why you think some women might be habitually single?
Well, let me do this, Brother Jeffrey. I want to stick to what I want to call for, man. That's way out of my lane, man. Listen,
Fair enough. We're going to come back to you, though. You know we're going to come back to you and talk about next level. All right. All right. Now, good doctor, what say you? Dr. Moore.
I would say the reason that some women are single is the same reason some men are single. It's a lack of commitment.
I love it. Straight to the point. No chaser. I love it. Pamela, what would you say? Why some women, not all women, some women are habitually single?
I think by choice. I think we focus our careers and sometimes we just don't have time for that.
Oh, they're working on themselves, fellas. Now, fellas, don't think I'm letting y'all off the hook. This is just not me talking about the women. Fellas, I'm not letting you off the hook. You are next. All right, fellas, some of y'all are single simply because you broke as hell. No, I'm not talking about being financially broke. I'm talking about being emotionally broken, emotionally unavailable, emotionally immature. I'm talking about being emotionally unwilling to grow and be better than you are. You've accepted the limitations that have been cast down on you. So you have settled now for being less than. Somebody told you when you were young that this is all you could be, and you bought into it. Somebody told you when you were young, you can't do this, and you're still not doing that because of what they told you when you were 5 or 6 or 7 or 8, and you're 40-something. At some point, you're going to have to take control of your manhood, your masculinity, your own path. And I promise you this, when you have that wealth on the inside, it gives you mental health, mental clarity, and mental wealth. You won't be able to stop good people from coming into your life. But you still broke with bad credit and no spirit. It's probably why you single. Told you, fellas, I wasn't letting you off the hook. Pamela, anything to add there?
No, nothing.
Oh, see, boom, she agrees 100%.
I don't know what men are thinking. I don't know why they're single. I have nothing to say.
Understood, I appreciate that. Dr. Moore, what do you think, sir? Okay. Good deal. Now, good Judge Patterson?
Well, you know, I'm judges and lawyers have to be honest. And so William Bell made a song back in the 70s,
yes,
and
sir.
It sounds like this. Trying to love too ain't easy to do. So that's the reason.
Okay. I just wanted to get that out the way. Because for the rest of the show, we're going to get into some serious stuff. Now, we're not going to be so serious that you don't want to pay attention, because this is stuff that you can use as relevant to everything that you do on the day today. And it's impacting our community in a serious way. So what I'd like to do here, first of all, I'd like to talk to Dr. Moore. Dr. Moore, if you will, I just have a few questions for you. First of all, tell us about the book that you have written.
Two weekly letters to my beloved daughters. And that book, the genesis of the book came out of a divorce. I was worried about losing custody of my two daughters, and so I decided to write them a letter once a week, and I did it for 52 weeks on various topics, and the format of the letter was I started off with an introduction, a topic, a reflection, and something about me. So at the end of the year, they could never say they didn't know anything about that book.
Mm. I love it. I love it. Now, let me ask you this. Since you were writing this to your daughters, can you give us a tip or some clues for future fathers who may have a daughter at some things that a father should do for his daughter as she grows up?
A father should always show love for their daughters and actually their sons as well. Mm-hmm. And my first letter was actually basically talking about the unconditional love I have for my daughters. But the other thing a father really should show and demonstrate to their daughters and their children is that they are protectors and they're full of trust.
Okay. All right. Now, I think it's important, and Brother Gary, we're going to come to you next. I think it's important that men really recognize how vital it is that we be present, not just sending a check, not just having that automatic payment debited every month or every week, but that we are present, because it's an investment that we're making that makes an incredible difference. And Brother Gary, with that, I kind of want to jump to you and what you are doing to help affect change in some men who may have grown up without knowing their father. Tell us a little bit about what you do, Brother Gary.
Yes, I'm the founder and executive director of Next Level Boys Academy. It's an innovative mentoring organization. We've been around 11 years. One of our most effective programs is our diversion program, which is an alternative to incarceration program.
Okay.
Where we are diverting 100,000 years of prison time a week.
Mm.
What the trend that I'm seeing is, of course, there's a lot of these young men that's growing up with no dads, man. And I think one of the things that we try to do is teach sex education. You know, you got to understand that everybody that you like or everybody that you feel that you're comfortable having sex with shouldn't have a baby by you. So what happens is, I think that black and brown men are genuinely good guys. I think we're very civil people, but we sometimes get ridiculed because we don't have the extra stuff that comes with building a relationship with the woman that we had a baby by. And so what happens is, when that relationship gets tense, we go our separate ways. Because sometimes mothers don't understand, or young men don't understand, or young ladies don't understand that, it takes a lot to raise the kids, man. And what I'm learning, Brother Jeffrey, is they just lack an education, man, as to what it looks like to procreate with somebody.
Wow.
And they're just making babies. When a young man meets a woman, I think for the most part, a lot of women don't know this, but we know within the first few minutes whether or not we want a family with you. So when we realize that you get pregnant by us and we leave you and the child, for some men that's easy to do because they never envision a family with you and they can't take the extra stuff that comes with relationships. So we're just educating young men on safe sex, if you're going to have sex. And should you have a baby by a woman, man, there's other things that comes with this that you got to fight just to be a father.
Understood. Thank you so much for that feedback, Brother Gary. Judge Patterson, I want to come to you, and then Pamela, I'm going to come right to you after we speak to Judge Patterson. From your time on the bench, can you talk to us a little bit about some of the cases you've seen and what it looked like perhaps having young black men come before you and having to preside over those types of hearings?
You know, I have to admit there's nothing wrong with single parent households, but the other issue is there just hasn't been a father figure in those households.
Mm-hmm. Understood. Now, folks, what I'm doing here is I'm kind of setting up a progression. We started with Dr. Moore, fatherhood. We talked to Brother Gary and what could happen when you don't have a father present. And unfortunately, if some of those men happen to end up in a situation, they might come before a judge like Judge Patterson. In the instance that they happen to get arrested and there becomes a situation where they have a bond set, a lot of men just don't have the cash.
So with that, Pamela, I'd like to talk to you now for you to tell us about the Love Project 404. Tell us about the project.
So it's a group of women. We all came together and, you know, we said, how can we help our community? What can we do for those that need us the most, especially during COVID-19? Mm-hmm. So we have four initiatives that we're working on. The one that we just did was the bailout. It started off on Father's Day, and folks just couldn't afford to pay their bail of $1,000, $500, and they were sitting there, and Judge Patterson will know, they were sitting there for months without a court hearing, because all court hearings have been canceled due to COVID-19. So a lot of them were just sitting there kind of wasting time. So we got involved, we bailed them out, which leads us into our initiative that we have now, which is with Gary. Mm-hmm. So we're actually sending all of our guys to Gary so that they can be mentored. A lot of them don't have a good relationship with their dads. Mm-hmm. They don't have a lot of family support, and they need that male role model who's gonna be there for them, and that's Gary. We're gonna put them through his pretrial diversion program so that by the time that they do get to court, maybe those cases will be dismissed and they won't have a record.
Understood.
So super excited about that.
Wonderful, wonderful. Now, folks, you see how we kind of tied this whole show together. I told you this was going to be a show that's giving you things that are important to our community. Brother Gary, I want to bounce back to you before I come back to you, Dr. Moore. When Pamela says, Gary, we have this brother that we are working with, and we want to send him through your diversion program. Tell us about the intake process that you may take that person, that gentleman, through to become a part of your organization.
Well, we do what we call an integrated summary, whereas I get to know as much about this young man as I possibly can, dating back to as early as he can remember his life, which is sometimes age 3 or 4, and just kind of identify his strengths and his weaknesses. And then the most important thing that we do, because I know the number one crime prevention is jobs. And education and money controls a lot of stuff that's going on in the community. So we get them employed. If they, you know, if they need a GED, we'll source that out. They get a GED, and so they spend about a year with us, and we put this safety plan in place where they have short-term goals to meet. Every 3 months, we're making sure they meet a goal, because we know as men that we like to celebrate the small victories. Mm-hmm. So you don't set anything, a goal that's unrealistic. So I think she had like 3 young men that started with us, and I think 2 of them are now working. One young man had a small goal of just having something as simple as a cell phone, because mm-hmm. he's been locked up for 7 months. So he won at that. So you just put goals in place that they can win, and we're with them for a year. So our ultimate goal is when we go back to court, we can present to the DA that, hey, listen, he's working, he's now getting his GED, he's not gotten any trouble since he's been out, and our success rate on that is like 98%. Mm. Most young men that come to our diversion program, they do not go to prison.
Mm. I love it. Now, everybody, need you to understand something. I had the pleasure of sitting in on a meeting this past Tuesday with the Love Project 404, and I saw some of the gentlemen that have gone through the program, who have been assisted by both the Love Project 404. Did I get it right, Pamela?
Yes.
Wonderful. Through them, they met with Gary, and Gary took them through the next level academy for boys. Did I get it right, Gary?
Next Level Boys Academy.
Next Level Boys Academy. I won't mess up again.
No problem.
But when I heard these gentlemen speak, they spoke with hope. They spoke with a vision. They spoke with a plan, and they spoke as if they had an internal motor that had been given the right type of fuel. So as I turn to you, Dr. Moore, a question I have for you is, if there's a gentleman who's gone through the process and he's gotten himself right, he's right back on the right track, what steps would you recommend to him to get involved, if he has a child, to get involved with his child at that point?
Well, if a gentleman has, I'm assuming they've been away from that child for a bit, so mm-hmm. and that child doesn't really know them. And so if that's the case, the first thing I would say is that they should really walk the talk. Don't just go in and say, this is what I'm going to do, and not be able to follow up. And take it slow, build trust with your child, and be loving. That's how you start off, and relationships take time. It's not a microwave situation. So you got to just take it slow and show the child you love them and you're there for them, and they can depend on you.
I love it. Now, Pamela, you mentioned earlier about how people may just be wasting away or wasting time because they're not unable to pay the bond. Can you tell us about your experience when trying to bond someone out? How does it impact you and what you're trying to do individually?
It's a very tedious process. I mean, just getting the nominations from the public defenders and the criminal defense attorneys. I mean, some of these young guys, 18, 19, have been there for 6 months on a $1,000, $2,000 bail. And again, with no court hearing set. And then, you know, we've been able to raise a lot of money to be able to post their bails. Once we post their bails, we want to wait on them. Mm-hmm. And then that process takes 24 hours. So with, like, you know, the judicial system is definitely not to our benefit. And in fact, we bailed somebody out who had not been getting the proper medical care. And the next day he ended up going to the ER having two surgeries. And he called us and said, my doctor said if I would have stayed at the jail for a couple more days, I would have died because I was not getting the proper medical care that I needed. And I mean, things like that, it's just very overwhelming. And you feel like you're really helping people out when they most need it.
I love it. Now, I'm going to say this and I'm going to come right back to you, Judge Patterson. One thing that I enjoyed about the call that I experienced on Tuesday was the level of commitment. The women that were there were emotionally vested in the program. One challenge that I'm going to issue to the men is to get involved. Get involved in the process. When women say, women got our back, you know, black women say, we're always there for you, black men, and we're looking for some reciprocity. I saw that on Tuesday. I saw women having these young men's back in a way that's just, it's just transformational. So to all of the men in my circle, if you haven't done anything yet, this is the cookout, the one we always inviting everybody else to. These types of steps, this is the cookout with what Brother Gary is doing. That's the cookout. Now, I'm sure by the time we're done with the interview with both Brother Gary and Sister Pamela, you'll know how you can contribute and be a part of the program financially. I'm sure they won't turn that down. I can tell you they also won't turn down your presence and your physical efforts to help the initiatives keep going. Don't sign up, though, if you're going to half-ass it. You're going to show up one day and be late or not keep your commitments. We're not looking for that. It's enough of that going around. We're looking for that serious investment that's going to yield a high return because the product is better men for our women. Better communities for our children, and a much more holistic view of where our community is going in the future. Judge Patterson, I'd like to ask you this question. With your law firm, what do you primarily focus on in assisting people legally?
Three things. One is criminal defense, and that ranges from speeding tickets all the way to murder.
Okay.
Also personal injury, ranging from car accidents, slip and falls, and things of that nature.
Okay.
And just recently in the last 3 years, I've also started doing civil rights, primarily police brutality.
Okay, good deal. Now, speaking of that, when a person, male or female, is stopped by the police, what do you recommend they should do at every step?
The biggest thing they should do, the number one thing they should do, is simply cooperate and obey. Meaning that when I say obey, arguing with the police on the street, you mm-hmm. will lose each and every time because that person with that gun and badge has the last word on the street.
Mm-hmm.
You get your time to have the last word in court when you're being defended by an attorney. But it is important that when you're stopped by the police, don't argue with them. You know, simply give your driver's license, answer his questions. Now, keep in mind, if he tries to arrest you, you do not want to resist. That is a no-no, because the time to defend yourself is when you're in court.
Okay, fair enough. I want to play the other side of the coin with you in this scenario. If I am informed, I know what the laws in the state of Georgia are, and the officer says to me, hey, where are you going? And I don't answer. Am I within my rights?
You absolutely are. You have absolutely no duty other than to give him your driver's license and produce insurance, even though now insurance is on the computer. You have no obligation to answer any of his questions. The problem with that is that the officer is going to get a little agitated because you exercising your rights. That's how things escalate. So it's nothing wrong with saying, officer, I'm on the way home. I mean, what is that going to hurt to keep things from being escalated?
Excellent point. Counterpoint. I am not the professional here. I am the civilian in the interaction. Why do I have to assume the role of keeping things calm by invoking my own right to be silent?
Great point. Unfortunately, we living in a society where we have police brutality. You have white officers and black officers that simply waiting on an opportunity to assault you, but they're waiting for you to give them a legal reason. Mm-hmm. And the fact that you're saying, I don't want to speak to you, that officer is going to take it to another level, and then that's going to make you take it to another level in some cases, and then it really gets out of hand. The best policy is to just simply be cool. You know, what's wrong with, I have no problem with saying, officer, I'm just leaving a club, or I'm just leaving my mother's house, my father's house, and then give him my driver's license. If I get a traffic ticket, fine, I'll defend that in court. That's what I would do.
Understood. Now, I'm just speaking for Jeffrey here. I don't speak. I don't say anything. Here's my license. I'm not saying anything because I don't have to.
That is correct.
It's a fishing expedition when they start asking me all these questions. I don't roll my window all the way down. I have it down far enough where they can see it. I don't have tint on my vehicle, but I have it down far enough where if I do anything and I put anything out the window, it's no big deal. That's just how I operate. You do what's best for you. I will say to you, though, that I firmly believe, and no disrespect at all, it's not a lack of training with some officers. It's just a lack of common courtesy. If I say I don't want to speak, no big deal. It's nothing against you. I'm just invoking my right to remain silent, and that is still legal in this country. I love that discussion, love that discussion. Pamela, I want to come back to you very quickly here and just talk about the Love Project 404. When people are being identified for the program, tell us how that works a little bit and what counties you actually work in at this time.
So we're working on DeKalb and Fulton right now, and we're getting nominations from the Public Defender's Office and from private criminal defense attorneys. They send us an application that we prepared, a nomination form with all of their information and why they should be bailed out. We then sit down with our board, we review it, we speak to their family members, and then we approve of those that move forward, and then we go ahead and post their bond the next day at 8 a.m., and then we wait for them all day to be released so that we can greet them with a goodie bag, gift cards. Gary is there to talk to them and just give them some hope after they've been in jail for so long and let them know that things are going to be okay.
You know, I've seen a couple of the videos that have been shared on Instagram. Can you just explain the reaction of the people when they walk out? What are you seeing? What energy are you getting when they are first bonded out through the project?
So the great part is that they're very much surprised. So even though we could be there all day and we're exhausted, when they come out and you see that face of, you know, just light up and say, oh my gosh, you're here for me? You know, it's kind of like, yes, we're here for you, of course. And you know, you just have a lot of support from the community. I think that makes a big impact. A lot of their family members, when we talk to them, they're like, oh, we don't have time. We can't go pick them up. We can't get out of work. So I think to have someone there waiting for you just says a lot, and it kind of starts a new way of life where people will be here for you and we will support you.
All right, Dr. Moore, before I come to you, I just want to say there's something profound in what Pamela just said. She explained how someone was there for someone else. and how that just empowered them and helped them feel love. Fellas, this is a challenge to you again. There's a rightful hierarchy, and I don't mean that in the patriarchal way, but there's a rightful hierarchy in our community that's just not lined up right now. And I believe it's the lack of provision and protection from us. See, what Pamela is doing, and this is not to denigrate any woman out there, what she's doing is she's providing a different type of nurturing. We don't necessarily do that. Just imagine if there were more men being the backbone of the organization, better yet, the foundation of the organization, so that the nurturing that's being spread, the energy that's being spread, the joy that's being spread, if they could do that without having to worry about other things that men could do. I'm not saying women can't do it. I am not saying that at all. I'm saying that when we play our role, it makes it easier for women to do what women do, however they define that. Again, Pamela, please don't take it the wrong way. You ladies are amazing. You're doing a phenomenal job. All I'm saying is, men, if we help join efforts like this, it makes it easier for them to do what they're already doing naturally.
And I want to say, Jeffrey, that I got to give a shout out to Jackie. I didn't know he was going to be on this call, but he's a huge supporter of the Love Project already, because he helped us in our initiative last year for the Harvard Diversity Project, where we help young kids get into Ivy League schools. And just recently, I found a check written by Jackie Patterson, and I texted him. And, so we do appreciate all the support. This is a communal effort. Women, men, everybody. If we can get behind these young kids, these young men, we can really change their lives. And just doing in whatever way we can do best. Some of us can just donate. Some of us can be there. Some of us can write letters of encouragement. Some of us, like Gary, can mentor, mm-hmm. right? Some of us, like Jeffrey, can provide a platform. Mm-hmm. Whatever you do, do it for the greater good of our community, and we can all move forward.
Excellent, excellent. Dr. Moore, well said, Pamela. Dr. Moore, speaking of fatherhood, can you speak on what fathers can do to really impart good stuff, wisdom, and things of that nature in the community?
One of the things that fathers should do is they should be involved in the community. What I notice in the other community is they spend a lot more time with family and they don't do things in the community. Whereas we spend, I think, a lot more time in the community because we have to. We don't have the same support they have in their community, the resources, so we have to step up in our community. Mm-hmm. Whether it's supporting our youth programs or mentoring or educational enrichment programs, or even trying to develop the economics of the community. So we have to work together as teams. We have to collaborate together to get things done. And that's very important. It doesn't matter who's leading it, as long as it's getting done.
Understood, understood. Dr. Moore, turning to your book, can you read a quick excerpt from your book for us, please?
Okay, a quick excerpt. Mm-hmm. I could go to the letter I wrote to the dads in the foreword. Would you prefer that one or one to the daughters?
Let's do the one to the dads. That'll be perfect.
Okay. All right. I wrote, "Dear dads, I took the first step by writing these letters to my daughters. Now all you have to do is share these letters with your daughters. The format that I use for the weekly letters to my daughters in this book start with a personal comment, then a just sharing section, followed by the letter. After the signed letter, I provide a reflection and then a dad factoid, just a little fact about me. In some instances, I will have an author's note. You can share these letters during a weekly phone call or in-person meeting by Skype, Snapchat, Facebook, email, or by simply writing a letter inspired by my book to your daughters. I welcome the opportunity to hear of your successes and how this book has strengthened your relationship. I will be grateful if you and your daughters will consider dropping me a line by visiting my website. I would definitely respond. I thank you for being the best dad to your children you can be. Thank you for being the best parent to your children you can be. Thank you for your willingness to reach out and reach in. This means your children will always be proud to know you as their number one dad. Dr. Edmund H. Moore."
I love it. Thank you so much, sir. Brother Gary, let me ask you this question. What inspired you to start the program that you started?
Man, you know, I was working for the state of Georgia in special investigations, and, you know, just at that time, I think it was like back 08, 09, making six figures, and I was just coaching Little League sports on the south side of Atlanta in the Waccamaw, old national area,
mm-hmm.
and had two sons I was coaching in basketball and football and baseball, and I just knew that the hour and a half that we was getting in practice wasn't enough, so I wanted to do something in addition to coaching. So I remember being in my office. I'll never forget this, man. It was probably the day that President Obama was sworn in his first term. I remember my boss at that time scheduled a meeting during this for whatever reason. So I didn't go to the meeting. I snuck in this vacant room and I watched this whole ceremony, and I was like, man, this guy's about to be the president of the United States, and he's only like a few years older than me. So I quit my job the same day. I submitted a resignation letter, and I said, you know, I don't want 2 weeks, I'm ready to go. I was on the job for maybe 10 years, so when I quit my job, I didn't know what I wanted to do. It was 3 months later during that time, I just kept praying, God, I need to do something to make me have more purpose in my life. And so I found that every time I was driving to the baseball field or to the basketball court to coach my sons, I got this joy. I got this excitement. I said, you know what? This is what I need to be doing. So I started a summer camp in May of 2009 with just 10 young men. And each year I implemented different programs, after school, basketball, soccer. I had a boot camp. And then the first year I did this, and every year we do this thing, because the mother and son ball, where the young men take their moms out on a date on Mother's Day weekend and celebrate them.
Hmm.
So we just had our 10th year anniversary last year at the Delta Flight Museum. It was an all-white event. So, man, I just wanted, I knew that this world was getting to a place where it is now as it relates to black and brown young men. And I just wanted to give more. I wasn't a troubled kid growing up. I don't have troubled sons. I have a son that's a senior in college, a freshman in college. So I don't have those issues. I just knew that in order for this world to be a better place, I got to go back and start with the young African-American males. And 5 years ago, just like me and all you guys, every time I turn on the news, I'm always hearing a black boy dying or going to jail. So I submitted a proposal to the Fulton County Court. I said, hey, listen, there's some good young men that's getting caught in bad decisions that shouldn't go to prison. And that is that population of young men that I started working with in our diversion program. The very first kid we had was Kimari Avery. He got kicked out of Washington High School, had to go to Forest Hill. When I met him, he was facing 25 years in prison. I said, hey man, we're gonna flip these 25 years to 25 football offers. And so now he's a tight end for the University of Louisville. He should be the first tight end at the draft next year. So he was my very first student, man. We did some anger management with him. He was sleeping in the, when I met him, he was sleeping in the laundry room in a one-bedroom apartment over by the Greenbrier area. So I was able to get some people, man, and get his mom in a three-bedroom apartment. And so this kid is going to be in the NFL in another year. So he was one of those young men that Fulton County took a risk on in the program. And also I had a case with Dr. Jack, with Mr. Patterson. He had a case in Fayette County that I testified on the kid's behalf, character reference. The kid last name Wright, they retrialed the case. He beat the case and they retrialed the case. And Brother Patterson beat it twice, man. So I was a character reference on that young man because I like to go into the courts and say, hey, listen, you may see him as a criminal, but he's a human being who got caught in a bad situation. So that is what I normally do at Next Level Boys Academy.
Outstanding. I love it. I love it. Judge Patterson, before I come back to you, Pamela, I know you said that we had you until about 9 o'clock and we got started a little late. So I'd like for you to tell people how they could reach you, how they could follow the project, and what they can do to get involved.
Yes, I would ask everyone to follow us on Instagram. It's the THE Love Project 404. Also, you can send us an email at theloveproject404@gmail, or you can go to our website, theloveproject404.org. We just started our fundraising campaign for the Next Level Boys Academy. So we're gonna go really, really hard on that, and we need all hands on deck and everyone helping, donating, and raising awareness to what Gary is doing with these boys and with our Baileys. So important and so necessary. So join us.
Absolutely. Can you give that contact information one more time to make sure they write it down?
Yes. So our website is the T-H-E Love, L-O-V-E Project, P-R-O-J-E-C-T 404.org. You can send us an email, the same at Gmail. You can follow us on Instagram, The Love Project 404, and just stay in touch, and you know, that way we can let you know of the volunteer and donating opportunity.
Folks, if you have not seen it before, just go look at the videos. Look at on Tuesdays, if you can join the town halls, just join them and see the amount of energy and passion that they have for this project. It's just infectious. I'll tell you that it inspired me, and I thought I was already involved, but I'm gonna be even more involved because this is something that's necessary, and if we can do more, do it. Don't think about it, don't talk about it, actually execute on it, and we'll be better. Pamela, thank you so much for joining us. I really appreciate it. Look forward to working with you even more in the future.
Absolutely, thank you guys.
All right. Thank you. Have a good evening. All right, Judge Patterson. Actually, Dr. Moore, let me check with you on time. Are you good on time?
Sure.
Wonderful, just want to make sure. Judge Patterson, let's talk about it a little bit.
I got it to about 9:15, and if you want to get back to me, so.
Okay.
That's okay.
Let me go back to Gary. Absolutely. Because I did have other things I wanted to talk to you about, Brother Gary.
Yes, sir.
All right,
yes,
tell us how people could get involved, first of all, with what you're doing and your program.
Well, of course, one of the things that we do is, in our gang, I use a very unique way for gang intervention and prevention program. I know it takes money, man, to compete with these gangs out here. So what we do is, we never try to encourage a young man to get out of a gang. We just try to love on a young man at that same level. Which it takes a pair of shoes, it takes a cell phone, it takes getting a job. So it just takes a lot of money for us to compete with the big homies out here, to compete with the streets, because most of these young men, Jeffrey, man, they just hungry, man. They just have something simple as a meal. So we probably spend $4,000 or $5,000 a month just on food gift cards. We make sure that everybody's phone bill pays. So we try to put them in a position that they shouldn't want for anything, man. So our website is nextlevelboysacademy.com. That's nextlevelboysacademy.com. And that's on all of our social media sites as well. Mm-hmm. We have a Zoom call every Saturday morning. It's live, it's virtual. So if you're interested in getting on that call, we kind of send the links out because we max out at 100 people in 30 minutes. So we just try to monitor that. So, and we just welcome men presence, man. I think a young man, in order for him to be it, he has to see it. Mm-hmm. So we have a team of 30 mentors, which is law enforcement, professional athletes, music, musicians. As you know, Killer Mike is heavily involved. He's endorsed it. I've been on the Stephen Colbert show with him. We just did a commercial with McDonald's for the BET Awards. And we're just getting the message out there, man. I can't save them all, but I will save the ones that have access to me.
Understood. I appreciate it. Now, I just want you, before you go, to kind of talk about the spirit that these young men had. On Tuesday, one brother started a clothing line. Another brother was looking for an opportunity. Then you had another brother that just started working at a restaurant on Memorial Drive. Can you just talk about the renewed spirit that I alluded to earlier? Of these young men when they come to the program?
Yes, what I was telling you earlier about it costs money to run an organization like this, because the first young man that you saw that came on and started the clothing line, so he was a star basketball player at McEachin High School. He got caught in some trouble. He got kicked out of school, lost his basketball scholarship, and I think Cobb County was trying to give him like 30 years in prison. So he was able to get that situation diverted over to us. And he's now a rising freshman at Kennesaw State. So he reached out to me and said, hey, man, I want to start my clothing line. I asked him, what does it cost? So we talked about it. So we was able to buy him a camera, the whole package, give him $500 of credit and t-shirts. And I just talked to him today, man. Actually, the clothing line actually launched today. The other young man we talked about, he was looking at 15 years in prison. He had to spend 3, and of course diverted the remaining 12 years to us. He's now working at Home Depot. So some of our partners are Home Depot, UPS. They actually come to us and interview young men at our facility every 3 months and hire them on the spot. Mm. So we know that jobs, man, economics control crime, economics control a lot of things. Economics and education is two of the things that we push. And our goal is that college is not for everybody, but 80% of our young men are at a technical college.
I love it. I love it. Brother Gary, again, can you tell people how they can get in contact with you if they want to support the organization or find out more information?
Yeah, just go on our website. It's nextlevelboysacademy.com. That's N-E-X-T level, L-E-V-L, boysacademy.com. You can follow us on Instagram at Next Level Boys Academy, Facebook at Next Level Boys Academy. And just join us on our Saturdays virtual class. Another unique thing that people don't know about us, Jeffrey, is that every day of the week we have something. So we're becoming a community organization. So on Monday nights we have this thing called Mondays with Moms, or Moms Matters. I just wrote my first book entitled Raising Him Without Him. So all these mothers have a book donated to them, and they're actually going over these books of, I think he's smoking weed, I think he's having sex, I think the gangs got him, he's missing his dad, I think he likes the same sex. So they're having a book club for the mothers on Mondays. On Tuesdays, I meet with the mentees and the fathers to just empower us. The mentors and the fathers. On Wednesdays, it's just me and the mentees. And then on Fridays, we have our team meetings. On Saturdays, man, we just invite the whole community. Prior to the pandemic, we were averaging 200 to 250 people every Saturday morning at 8 o'clock. Mm. Our facility is located in Union City, Georgia.
Okay, good deal, good deal.
And Brother Gary, before you go, I want to definitely say I really appreciate the work that you did in the 2 trials that I had in Fayette County. Without your testimony, I believe that my client would have been convicted. The work that you did made such a huge impact on those 2 trials, and I really appreciate it.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
All right, Brother Gary, thank you so much for everything that you do, first of all, for the young men that are coming up to become the fathers in the future, and, of course, everything you're doing right now. We appreciate you, and thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, brother. Y'all have a good night. Brother Patterson, I'll hit you up, man, and let's try to connect, see if I can support you in any of your cases.
That works.
Yes, sir.
All right. Take care. Take care. Uh-huh. All right. Dr. Moore, we have you and Judge Patterson here, so we're going to chop it up about some stuff, and I'd love to have your input on it as well as it relates to community issues. One thing that's really big right now that's going on in our community more than anything else is the Black Lives Matter movement and the implication, the impact that it's having right now on the community more accurately. First of all, I just want to know what you feel, and this is for you, Dr. Moore, what you feel about the Black Lives Matter movement and the impact they're having right now.
I think the Black Lives Matter movement is making a great impact. I've been trying to convince, and I think I finally am convinced of some of my my peers who are older, that by them not having a formal leadership, that's an advantage. Mm. And the fact that when you have a formal leader, that leader gets attacked, they get discredited, they kill the movement that way. But without it being personality and leader led, it makes it a little bit more effective in that you can't attack it. And that's really frustrating that other community. Mm. That they don't have a person to attack. So I think it's been very effective. There's a lot of issues that have been addressed, whether it's police brutality, defunding police, not just to take money away, but to ensure that the appropriate resources are being used. If you have someone with mental health conditions, You don't need a person with a gun going in and tasering. You need a social worker, someone that's skilled in that area.
Fair
to,
enough.
Go to that call. And that's where those resources need to go in situations like that.
All right, fair enough.
And the last thing I say, just for that conversation you had with the judge about a police officer approaching you and not speaking, what happens if the person is deaf or hard of hearing? They get the crap beat out of them.
Unfortunately, that has actually happened.
Yes, it has.
Judge Patterson, let's pivot to you. With the Black Lives Matter movement, what are your thoughts about the impact they're having right now?
Well, I think the Black Lives Matter movement really, to me, has been in three phases in our society.
Okay.
I think one phase was the anti-lynching movement back in the 1800s.
Yes, sir.
I think the next movement was the voting rights movement during the civil rights days.
Okay.
And today, it is the Black Lives Matter movement of simply stop having the police kill our innocent men. I think it's Black Lives Matter movement has always been around, but I do believe that the death of George Floyd, as tragic as it may be, it went further than a Black Lives Matter movement. It became a revolution. I'm convinced that the Black Lives Matter movement is really a revolution and is changing the world. You have white people that are now seeing, looking in the mirror, saying, I need to change. And I've seen some white people that are actually changing as a result of this revolution.
Absolutely. Now, Brother Terry Crews had some comments on this. We're going to play what Terry Crews had to say, and then we'll come back and talk about it in just a moment. One thing I want to touch on here, during the civil rights movement in Birmingham, Alabama, Bull Connor sicked some dogs and fire hoses and the police on kids marching. And it was televised around the country. And the president at the time, I believe it was President Lyndon Baines Johnson, said, we have to do something. Because the optics, I'm paraphrasing, the optics look bad. Imagine how it felt. So one thing that I will say that has come out of the pandemic that was a silver lining out of all this is people had nothing else to do but watch TV. There wasn't no football, there wasn't no baseball, there wasn't no distractions. And then when it happened, when George Floyd was murdered on TV, everybody saw it. Not just in America, but worldwide. So I agree with you 100%, and I agree with you as well, Dr. Moore, 100%, that this is something that is transformative, and it's really taking us to the next level. I want to touch on something very quickly. Before we started the show, Judge Patterson was talking about his legal assistant. I want you to tell us that story really quickly, because I want to touch on something after you tell the story. Go right ahead, sir.
About what I did for my legal assistant.
Well, what your legal assistant did for you, and then what you did for
her. Yes, yes. Basically, I had COVID-19 early March. I was in the hospital for 30 days. I had to recover for 2 months after that. And my clients didn't even know that I was not at work because my legal assistant, office manager, Nora Clark, she covered every case. She kept the clients basically thinking that I was there every day. And today I had to surprise her and show her my level of appreciation. So I simply surprised her around 5 o'clock today, and I bought her matching watches. I bought me one, and I bought her a matching one. And it just overwhelmed her, and it overwhelmed me as well. And so you have to show appreciation when someone, when they hold you down when you can't hold yourself down.
The reason I wanted him to tell that story is because there is a reward that's due when someone invests in you. Now, your legal assistant went out of her way to make sure that you did not look bad in front of your client.
Absolutely.
That was an investment. It reaped dividends. When I say men, that there are things that we need to do, this is an example of it. That was an investment that was made in him and his business. Some people just come back and say, well, that was your job. You were supposed to do that. That's not how this works. When you have someone that takes a vested interest in you and they invest, you pay dividends. Sometimes it's material. A lot of times it's emotional support. It's gratification and appreciation to what they've done. And men, that's where we have an opportunity to do better by our women. All right, thank you so much for sharing that. And I'm really glad that you were able to come out of the COVID experience there, or the COVID infection. All right, Dr. Moore, let's chop it up. Before we get to this Terry Crews video here, when you talk about the movement not having one centralized leadership, you said that that was something that's a good thing this time around. How do you see this ending? What do you think is the end result of the Black Lives Matter movement and the wave that we're on right now?
What I see now is that now that the movement has hit the streets, agitated, got the world watching, especially after 8 minutes and 46 seconds mm-hmm. of the death of our brother up in Minneapolis. Mm-hmm. Now it's the role of the groups that work behind the scenes, the NAACP, the Urban League, and the legal justice groups to help put together, craft the legislation and the public policy to make sure that what we've been fighting for is implemented. And to monitor that it actually happens.
Hmm. Now, Judge Patterson, I was having a spirited conversation with one of my more conservative friends, and we were talking about, and I want to kind of shift here, we were talking about the relationship that municipalities and governments and, you know, organizations like that have with police unions. What do you see as an impact, as much as you care to speak, the impact of police unions on effective policing?
Well, first of all, police unions are powerful. Mm-hmm. They have a lot of money. Mm-hmm. If you notice, look at the money they've raised for Officer Roth, mm-hmm. who killed Rayshard Brooks. Mm-hmm. But these police unions have the ability now, they have the opportunity as well, to make a positive impact. Mm-hmm. Instead of just being on TV supporting the police 100%, I noticed recently they're trying to say, we just simply want justice for everyone. Mm-hmm. So they're trying to come around and do the right thing. Mm-hmm. But speaking on legislation, the biggest legislation now that was signed by the governor mm-hmm. is qualified immunity for the police.
Y'all listen to this now. Listen to this part. What bill was it attached to or came very quickly after?
It was attached to a bill that protects the police, where the police can sue you mm-hmm. if you make a false allegation against them. So if you have one end where you can sue the police now, mm-hmm. if first of all, it's going to be a constitutional amendment, mm-hmm. and the voters will get to vote on that in November. And the issue will be, would you like to see the police citizens have the ability to sue police and municipalities mm-hmm. and waive qualified immunity. Mm-hmm. But the backdrop to that is that now the police can sue you personally if it's determined that it's a false claim.
The term qualified immunity is something that's internationally used everywhere. The thing is, it's blanket immunity from virtually any type of prosecution. Virtually any type of prosecution.
Civil prosecution.
Thank you. Civil prosecution. So what's happened here, in my opinion, you keep me honest here, it seems like they've taken it, okay, we'll put this up here, but we're also going to put a little piece of something else right here at the same time. So really, an effective change of the law isn't happening. They're just splitting it. They're putting this over here to make you feel good, but they're going to get you on this end. You got to pay attention to the details of what happens in a lot of these states and a lot of this legislation. It's not the headline or the byline, it's the substance of the article. And right now, a lot of people ain't reading real deep in these articles. I love these types of discussions. Dr. Moore, let's talk about the kids really quickly again here. Now, how many daughters do you have, sir?
Two daughters.
All right, tell me now, when you were faced with the prospect of not having access to your daughter, how did it make you feel, and how did it spur you to action around the book?
Well, my daughters were, at the time, they were about 8 and 12. Mm. And so they were young. They probably didn't know what was the dynamics going on around everything. Mm-hmm. So anytime a man goes into a divorce proceeding, a man can lose his child, custody of his child. And that's because the court systems, systemically, they always gonna say that the woman is more able to raise the child. And that's what I was worried about. And that's why I started trying to work on a relationship more with my daughters by writing them the letters and that kind of thing.
Understood. Now, the book, when people want to purchase the book, where would they go? How could they get their hands on the book itself?
Well, the book is available at Barnes & Noble. It's available at Amazon. It is available through Kindle. And if a person wants to go in, so they can look up the book title, With the Father's Love, 52 Weekly Letters to My Beloved Daughters by Dr. Evan H. Moore, or they can go to my Facebook page and look under the name of Edmund Moore, or they can go to my Instagram or Twitter page. It's going to author underscore Dr. Edmund H. Moore.
Excellent. All right, now listen, if y'all don't know this about Jeffrey, Jeffrey loves good, engaging conversations about topical issues. I want y'all to understand something. And Dr. Moore and Judge Patterson, you guys indulge me just a second. Will and Jada having issues, y'all, in their marriage. And honestly, I don't care. Because the men who killed Breonna Taylor have still not been arrested. I just saw something that said Breonna Taylor's mother wanted to see a copy of the warrant that they used to invade that house or that apartment. And guess what? The response was, we can't find it. There's been some mix-up or something like that. Just imagine for a second that your child was taken from you, who had just been awarded, been recognized for outstanding service a few weeks prior, murdered, and there are no answers. The the prosecutor, DA, whatever, over there now, brother, I'm saying brother because he's still a brother, said, I'm not going to be rushed by anybody, celebrity or no, and just taking his sweet time. Now, one of the judges in Louisville, I cannot forget his name, but he's been censured, or whatever the word is, because of what he said. Mm-hmm. Disciplined. He's been disciplined because of what he said. But what he said was the truth. He was looking at the brother, Breonna Taylor's fiance, and he said, now I'm looking at everything here. I'm looking at what you're trying to charge him with, and it doesn't make any sense. This is not going any further. When I see that those types of things happen, it tells me that we need more people like that in the judiciary, more Judge Pattersons. We need more of us doing the right things in the community. Now, I'm not saying that Judge Patterson would look at someone who was clearly guilty and not follow the letter of the law. That's not happening. What I can tell you, though, is when people like us are able to represent us in a way that is truly legally blind, unbiased, unmoved, just looking at the facts of the case, then we have a leg to stand on. Before I get back to you, gentlemen, I just want to talk about something I read. There's a young brother who was attacked at a fraternity party. He said he went into a room, he saw people snorting a white substance, told him to get out of the room. He left. While he was trying to get out of the party, he got jumped by about four or five people. In defending himself, he stabbed two people. They didn't die. He's facing 56 years. He got attacked. He didn't run out and start stabbing people. He got jumped. And in defending himself, the judge said, I'm going to set an example. He's on record now. This is the judge. I'm going to set an example out of you. 56 years is what this young man is facing. That ain't blind justice right there. All right, let's get back to it. Judge Patterson, tell me about the most difficult case you faced while on the bench.
Well, I do primarily traffic cases, but I also have served part-time as a superior court judge and as a state court judge.
Tell us the difference so we know.
The difference is a municipal court judge, that I'm a permanent part-time municipal court judge in the city of Atlanta. Mm-hmm. I handle any type of offense that you can commit in an automobile, whether it be DUI, reckless driving, speeding. And I also served in the past as a part-time state court judge. The difference in that is that not only do you have the authority to handle all of the traffic offenses, but you also get to handle the misdemeanor non-traffic offenses like marijuana possession, battery, shoplifting. Mm-hmm. And I've also had the occasion to serve as a part-time superior court judge down in Terrell County, Georgia. Mm-hmm. And that's where I had my most difficult case.
Okay.
And that case involved a father who was alleged to have molested his 7-year-old daughter. Mm. And it happened over a couple of period of time. Mm. And throughout that trial, I have to admit, I was so emotional because I could not believe the evidence that was being presented. Mm-hmm. And the jury found him guilty. And I have to admit, I had to really call him everything in the book before I sentenced him. I think I gave him 80 years. Mm. As a judge, you have to give out the punishment that meets the crime.
Sure.
But I spent 30 minutes telling him how cruel of a person he was, mm-hmm. before I sentenced him. And he did do an appeal, and that appeal was lost. So that was my toughest case as a judge.
What grounds was he appealing on?
Well, he claimed that I violated the law as it related to picking a jury and things like that.
So he was looking for a technical appeal.
Yes. Oh,
okay, I get it now.
Absolutely.
Because I'm sure he wasn't trying to appeal the damage that he did.
Right. No, it was all procedural issues.
Okay. Understood. That. Now, listen, you know what? We'll save that for another show. But that's just a whole different animal right there. So, Dr. Moore, let me talk to you very quickly. Do you remember the Black Panther movement when they were in their heyday? Were you alive at that time?
I was alive, but I don't remember it.
Okay.
I read about it, but I don't remember it.
Understood. No worries. One thing I always take away from the Black Panther Party was how leadership wasn't just one person. Now, you saw Huey P. Newton and everything like that, but there were other leaders, male and female, throughout the party. The thing that sabotaged the Black Panther Party more than anything was the organizational structure. You could be doing something different in California than you were in Chicago or Atlanta. There was no homogenous type of methodology of doing things that could be repeatable, and you just, like a franchise, if you will. This is how you do it. This is how you do it. Everybody follow the plan. And that was one of the reasons why it was so easily broken up. I was going to ask, do you fear, since there's no centralized leadership, do you fear the same thing could happen with the Black Lives Matter movement?
I don't believe the Black Lives Matters can be broken up based on that, the way that the Black Panthers were. Mm. The other thing you got to realize about the Black Panthers, though, they also had infiltrators go into there from some of the FBI and other law enforcement agencies. That's the probably the biggest threat to the Black Lives Matter right now would just be infiltration and people committing violence and doing acts that get the public to turn against it.
Mm. Now, speaking of that, there have been all types of agent provocateurs caught on camera with a whole bunch of covering over their faces and everything, walking up to businesses, busting the glasses out, then walking off, throwing, you know, incendiary objects into stuff and walking off. And they've been recorded left and right. So I agree with you 100% that infiltration factor is still very, very real, because there are some people that are just looking for a reason to discredit what Black Lives Matter stands for. It kills me sometimes how you have someone on TV who's a political figure being questioned, can you say Black Lives Matter? And they just won't even say it. Well, I believe all lives matter.
Yes.
No, okay, but can you say Black Lives Matter? Well, all lives matter. I just don't get it. Of course, all lives matter.
One of my good partners out in California was talking to his white colleagues,
mm-hmm.
and they were referring to Black Lives Matter protests as riots.
Mm.
His question then was, how many people in a crowd does it take before you consider a riot? You got 5,000 people and one person's doing something, is that a riot? Hmm. And they never could give an answer.
That's a great question. I love it. I'm gonna keep that question in my back pocket. I'm gonna use it. I'm not gonna give you credit for it though, but I'm gonna use it. I'm gonna let you. All right, with logs well the same page there. All right, so Judge Patterson, let me ask you this question here. And this is going back to what you're doing with your law firm. When you're representing someone, how do you decide when to take on a client? Are you just open for anybody, or tell me what your criteria is?
There is, in other words, I represent anyone that's able to hire me.
Okay.
Because I don't judge my clients. You cannot be a good defense attorney if you say, well, I can't defend you because I think you might be guilty. Okay. Then you are not a good defense attorney.
Okay.
A good defense attorney takes the case, listen to what the client has to say, and then at that point, he looks at what the police say happened compared to what the client say happened, and then you put the law in the middle, and that's how you prepare a defense.
Okay. Now, when working with law enforcement, because, again, this is Jeffrey's perspective, sometimes it seems like the relationship with the judge and an officer can be pretty close because you see them all the time with familiarity. Exposure becomes familiarity, and human nature is some type of bond is going to be formed. How difficult is it to keep that line of demarcation between the judicial and the enforcement side separated? How difficult is that?
Great question. And to prove your point, not only do the police officer and that judge have some kind of relationship because of seeing each other, but imagine the prosecutor who's in the courtroom every day. That's even harder to deal with because what happens, judges will have a tendency to rule on in favor of the prosecution on every objection that I may make. Mm. So you have to keep fighting. Mm-hmm. That will never change. Mm. If the judge makes a ruling that's an unlawful ruling and your client gets convicted, then you appeal that. That's how you end up getting justice. But you shouldn't have to go that far if the judge just follows the law.
Absolutely.
But unfortunately, you have the prosecutor and judges in the judges' chambers having lunch, drinking coffee, and a defense attorney is nowhere around.
Wow.
That happens, and that will never change.
Mm. Okay. See, this is the thing that I enjoy about having guests like this on with us. You get to see a different side of the coin. Now, I want to turn back, first of all, Dr. Moore, to the book and to your writing. First of all, give us a little bit about your background. Tell us a little more about Dr. Moore. Dr. Edmund Moore, by the way. I'm sorry.
Well,
go ahead.
I was born in Noonan, Georgia, raised in LaGrange, Georgia.
Okay.
Went to school at Florida A&M University, matriculated to MIT, then to University of Florida and got a doctorate degree, and left there and went to work at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in Dayton, Ohio, for the Air Force.
Okay, so you've been all over the place a little bit there.
A little bit.
Good deal. How old are your daughters now?
18 and 15.
Okay, good deal. So when it comes to being a father with daughters, tell us some of the most difficult things that, I won't say difficult, some of the things that you found more challenging than you thought it would be.
The most challenging thing is right now, because they're both teens, and teens know everything.
I understand. I completely understand that. You're right. They know everything about everything there is to know. Good deal. So
I will say one thing. One of the chapters I wrote in my book was called Mind Reader.
Okay.
And what I tell them is I cannot read your mind. Mm. You really have to tell me what's on your mind. Don't just assume I know what you think. And that goes to our relationships.
Thanks
for communication.
Well, I can tell you, Dr. Moore, that I've got a daughter as well. She's 21. And let me tell you, I had an eye-opening experience because you always look at your daughter as being your little baby girl. And so when I had COVID, fortunately my ex-wife and I are best friends, so I had to sleep on her sofa for like 2.5 months so she could get me well, her and my daughter. Mm. And so I woke up one morning about 7 o'clock a.m., and I noticed my daughter was just coming in. So I assumed that my daughter might have went to the store maybe 30 minutes earlier. And so I said, baby girl, you know, where you coming from? She said, well, I've been out. And her mother came into the room and said, well, you know, she's 21 now. She left home at 8 p.m. and she stayed with her boyfriend till she's just coming back. I almost lost my mind because she literally spent the night with her boyfriend. So that was such an eye-opening experience.
Mm.
Yes. Yeah. So I know how you feel. I haven't gotten over that yet.
I understand. My daughter's roughly the same age as your daughter. So I understand completely what you're saying. It's a different type of perspective.
Yes.
Different perspective. All right. Now I want to talk about something that's happening in California. There's an initiative by one of my classmates. He's a city council person in San Francisco, I believe. And they have an initiative that will fine people for making frivolous 911 calls on people. Now, there was an interview, and the interviewer was like, do you think this could actually hurt 911 services? Now, before we get too deep with this, I'd like to ask both of you gentlemen. I'll start with you, Judge Patterson. Do you think that this type of legislation is something that should be replicated throughout the country?
Making frivolous 911 calls.
Being something you can be fined for.
Yes, I agree with that, because making a frivolous 911 call, you could be holding up the line for someone that's being robbed, kidnapped, carjacked. Yes, I strongly believe that if you make a frivolous or a false call to 911, I think you clearly should be punished.
Fair enough. Dr. Moore, what do you think?
For the most part, yes. You're going to have cases where you have kids make frivolous 911 calls, so you just have to make sure the law covers that situation fairly.
Absolutely.
But for adults in their right facilities making false 911 calls, yes.
Okay.
Because if you have a child that makes a frivolous call, they don't have the criminal intent that an adult would.
Sure, sure. Yes. That's the specific part about this legislation. It's not about someone who made a mistake and dialed 911 and hangs up. You know, it's still going to connect them whether you hang up or not. They're going to call back. It's not about that. It's about the person who willfully makes a call about someone writing Black Lives Matter in chalk on their own property, and then you pretending to know the person who lives there when the homeowner is actually writing it and you call the police. It's targeting those types of things. I personally think that it's something that should happen. Now, speaking of that, the young lady in New York who called 911 and said, "This black man is assaulting me," who was watching the birds, that young man has decided not to cooperate with the district attorney's office. Judge Patterson, what do you think about that?
You know, that's interesting, because if someone files a false report on me, I'm going to prosecute them. It's just that simple. I just cannot understand for the life of me why he will not cooperate.
Mm. Now, he said that she suffered enough. Dr. Moore, what do you think?
I agree with the judge in the situation, but also I see his point. She's lost her job. She's lost some other stuff. And it's his call. It's in his heart that he doesn't feel that he should participate in her prosecution. Mm. So he has to live with God on that call. That's up to him. From a society point of view, I would prefer that he would cooperate so we could stop this type of behavior in the future. But it's going to come down to his call.
You know, I agree with what both of you are saying. I think there's a point where it becomes bigger than just us. What that young lady did takes me all the way back to the Exonerated Five. Five young men who had years taken off of their lives, who were basically railroaded. I don't care how you try to say it. They were railroaded. They had evidence that they suppressed. I know that when They See Us came out, it kind of sensationalized. I get all that stuff. That was a TV miniseries. What happened in reality was worse. That was a great miniseries, but what happened in reality was worse. The vigor to go after those people, those young men, in New York at that time, that young lady knew exactly what she was doing. The amount of malice in her voice, she knew exactly what she was doing. I appreciate the brother for saying, you know, she suffered enough. I just respectfully disagree. She's earned everything that she's getting. That's it. You reap what you sow is what it is. wouldn't be me. I'm just going to leave it there. It would not be me. All right. So, Dr. Moore, let me ask you, what's next? You're writing another book. Tell me what's coming down the pipeline for you.
Well, I live in the quaint city of Dayton, Ohio, the capital of funk music.
All right.
And I'm working with a group called Parity, Inc. Mm-hmm. We work for the socioeconomic development of the African American community in Dayton, Ohio. And one of the things I would like to do is to write a book to help financially support the organization.
Okay. Good deal. Good deal. I love it. Now, one thing that I always try to do is I try to find interesting things that people might have missed. I saw a video of a young man being arrested. I don't know which city it was in, but he was being arrested and he was resisting arrest. There were some men around him who were recording the arrest, and the officer was a pretty big officer. The young man was a little slim guy, but the officer had his knee in his back. The man recording it said, "Hey, don't put your knee on his neck now." The officer said, "I got it. I won't." And they're still trying to get this young man arrested. Now, I have some friends in law enforcement. They told me it could be very, very difficult to get somebody's hands behind their back. There are certain positions you can do certain things that make it really difficult for them to arrest you. The police officer asked the young man, "Will you come help us?" Now, I don't know if you've seen it, Dr. Moore. What would you have responded to the police officers if they said to you, "Will you come help us arrest this young man?"
Ooh, probably would, if it was more than one policeman.
It was two.
It was two policemen?
Yep.
Beyond talking, I probably would not, because I probably would not have qualified immunity if it didn't happen.
You are exactly right there. You are exactly right. Judge Patterson, what about you?
You know, I have to admit, you know, I'm a former police officer.
Mm-hmm.
And if I see a police officer in a struggle, I don't know anything about the facts, but if the suspect is resisting, mm-hmm. and if I think the officer is in danger,
mm-hmm.
and the officer is not per se, you know, trying to harm the suspect to that degree,
mm-hmm.
yes, I would assist the officer because I think that's the form of police nature in me.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I would do that. And on the other hand, always remember, though, that a citizen has a right to resist an unlawful arrest.
Mm-hmm.
Now, keep in mind, I wouldn't know if that's an unlawful arrest if I'm just happen to be up on it.
Mm-hmm.
But I think I would intervene and help the officer just so I could calm the situation so no one gets seriously hurt.
Fair enough. Now, here is how it turned out if you have not seen the video. The young man was struggling. He had the handcuffs up under his body. He had one pair of handcuffs up under his body. The gentleman who was recording, the officer said, "Well, will you come help us?" The energy that the officers were giving off wasn't combative. They were like, "Come on, man, give us your arm. As opposed to, "Turn around, do this." You know, it was just something about the tone that these officers had. They were arresting you because they had no other choice. You broke the law, not because they had a bad day. Not because they were trying to break your arm. It was just something about the tone, the way they were speaking to each other and the way they were speaking to the men who were recording. And the man who was recording went over and said, "All right, listen, stop. Give him your hand. Come on now, give me your hand. And the young brother stuck his hand out. He still struggled a little bit, but they were able to arrest him. I think in some of the responses I saw to this was, he will get a chance to have his day in court rather than his family bury him. Now, I'm going to tell you quite honestly, if the officer is agitated or angry, it might not be safe for you to go over there because he doesn't know what you're getting ready to do.
That's correct.
They're thinking about self-preservation. And if they are in a heated situation and you start to approach, you are a threat. So I would advise, if you see anything heated like that, don't go up. Keep your distance. What these officers did, they asked for help. And they didn't ask for help in a heated situation. They asked for help getting control of the situation. Big, big, big difference. Honestly, that's the type of policing that I would love to see. You know, and I'm glad to know that you're an officer. I have, like I said, a lot of friends that I know in nearly every department around metropolitan Atlanta. And I worry about them. I worry about them because of the officer who has a chip on his shoulder unnecessarily. That bad apple that some police unions make it difficult to get rid of. Now, the saying is, one bad apple don't spoil the bunch. If you leave the apple in the barrel, it certainly will. You got to get the barrel out of the bunch. That's the rest of that story. All right, that's good. I love that. I love that right there. So I want to play this clip on Terry Crews. Brother Kush, can we get that clip? Because I can't go without talking about Terry Crews. If we can't get it, let me know. But the thing is, Brother Terry Crews was talking about, we got to be careful. We can't be so Black Lives Matter that we become superior. We can't, everybody, God loves everybody. So we're going to play this clip. We'll come back and talk about this clip because I was just floored. I didn't think he could say anything else as crazy as some of the stuff he said before, but he killed me. Go ahead and roll that clip for me, Brother Kush.
Don, you know, Black people need to hold other Black people accountable. I said this the same thing. This is the Black America's version of the Me Too movement. If anything is going to change, we ourselves need to look at our own communities and look at each other and say, this thing cannot go down. And this is the thing, too. There are a lot of great, great people there who are held hostage, who are held hostage by people who literally are running these neighborhoods with violence and then claiming that Black Lives Matter. When you look at the parents of these little kids who are mentioning, saying, hey, man, why aren't they speaking up for me, too? And this is what I'm saying. When I look at this whole thing about, you know, it's about who is controlling the narrative. It's got to be all Black Lives Matter. And what's happened is that because I even challenged it, because I even questioned and warned people,
Terry,
I became sick. If I told you to wear a mask,
Terry,
they want to kick you out.
You're a high-profile person. You're writing things out there. You know you're going to get backlash. You know people are going to respond to what you're saying on Twitter. So I don't think you should be surprised by that. I have a skin as tough as an armadillo because of what I do, and I think maybe you should adapt that. But here's what I have to say. The Black Lives Matter movement was started because it was talking about police brutality. If you want an all Black Lives Matter movement that talks about gun violence in communities, including, you know, Black communities, then start that movement with that name. But that's not what Black Lives Matter is about. It's not an all encompassing. So if you're talking about if someone started a movement that said cancer matters, and then someone comes in and said, why aren't you talking about HIV? It's not the same thing. We're talking about cancer. So the Black Lives Matter movement is about police brutality and injustice in that manner, not about what's happening in Black neighborhoods. There are people who are working on that issue, and if you want to start that issue, why don't you start it? Do you understand what I'm saying?
But when you look at the organization, police brutality is not the only thing they're talking about.
I know that, but I agree, but that's not what the Black Lives Matter movement is about, Terry. Black Lives Matter is about police brutality and about criminal justice. It's not about what happens in communities when it comes to crime, Black on Black crime. People who live near each other, Black people, kill each other. Same as whites. 80-some% of white people are killed by white people.
All right. Now, we started to get into that argument, Black lives only matter when white people kill Black lives. You know, but what about when, you know, we kill ourselves? So I'd like to explore that a little bit in a little time that we got left. So, Dr. Moore, how do you feel about what Brother Terry said?
Again, that's one of the issues with having an organization with not leadership. The Black Lives Matter really was about police brutality, and as a result of that, cleaning up the criminal justice system. I noticed that some other groups complained that the Black Lives Matter didn't cover the situation of trans and gays and other folks as well in the Black community. So that's just one of those things that's going to happen. If you start a movement, people are going to want to throw that piece in there as well.
Fair enough. Judge Patterson.
You know, Black Lives Matter movement should be about making black lives better, because every time you can avoid a police officer, a racist police officer, killing a black man, that is about making black lives better. Mm-hmm. So it should be. Black Lives Matter should be about making black lives better.
Fair enough. Fair enough. Now, I want everybody to understand something. There is no such thing as black on black crime. Proximity crimes happen in every single community. Now, I'm going to tell you honestly, I looked at the FBI crime stats, and we lead in one category, and we lead by a long way. And it's when we kill ourselves. Homicides in our community, the highest. And when you think about the population, it's even worse, because we are, what, 13, 14, 15% of the total population? Yet we lead in that category by a long margin. Let's not get it twisted, though. Proximity crimes happen at nearly identical rates. Our rate is the highest, but at nearly identical rate in every community, because people commit crimes against people they are closest to. We don't have people catching MARTA to Alpharetta committing a crime. It just doesn't happen that way. So let's get down to why crime is what it is in our cities, our inner cities. It's because of the lack of economic investment. If you are starving a community, it's a food desert, first of all, and then the only place they got to get food is a little convenience store that they don't even own, the Asians own. Nothing against Asians owning businesses. Now, I'm just saying that's the way it looks in a lot of communities around the country. The one grocery store is owned by an Asian. No disrespect or anything like that, just facts. If you create those types of environments and you allow people to live on top of each other, you're going to have conflict. Now, let's not get it twisted. We didn't build the ghettos. They've torn them down now, but we did not build those. We were forced into those. When our grandfathers and fathers came home from war, they would not give them the loans in the places they were building that would become the suburbs. They forced us away, and they told the banks, if you lend to a black person, we are not going to approve this loan. That was the federal government saying that. So after all those years of redlining, all those years of disparate treatment in the legal system, you're going to get what you've gotten. That's the macroeconomic level. On the microeconomic level, there is some accountability that we have to take. And I think it starts a lot with the fathers. I've spoken to enough police officers that have said to me, the number one thing most of these boys got in common is they ain't got no dad. They ain't got no male role model. They just out here hunting for somebody to love on them with a little masculine energy, not in a lover type of way, but the love that a father gives to a son. And in seeking that, they seek whatever they can get. And a lot of times, it's a game. So I want everybody to understand. I understand what Brother Terry was saying. I just think it was short-sighted, and it skirts the issue that we don't just have a problem with black-on-black crime that doesn't exist. Everybody has problems with proximity crimes. Don't magnify what happens in our communities like it ain't happening anywhere else. If you think I'm lying, just go back and look at Columbine or Sandy Hook or any of those other mass shootings. In the vast majority of that now, that wasn't us, and it wasn't against us. All right, we're getting close to the end of the show here. So, Dr. Moore, I'd like for you once again to tell people how they can contact you and where they can go and buy the book.
Okay, thanks for the opportunity. The book is With a Father's Love, 52 Weekly Letters to My Beloved Daughters by Dr. Edmund H. Moore, and that's Edmund with a U. The book is on Amazon, is on Barnes & Nobles, and it's on Kindle. You can reach me on Instagram at author_doctor.edmundh.moore, Facebook, Edmund Moore, or Twitter at Dr. Edmund H. Moore.
All right, wonderful. And give us the name of the book one more time.
What They Thought Is Love, 52 Weekly Letters to My Beloved Daughters.
Outstanding, outstanding. Thank you so much for being on the show. We certainly appreciate it, sir. Judge Patterson, if someone needed legal representation, how would they get in contact with you and where would they go?
Much easier than Dr. Moore. Just go to JackiePatterson.com.
All right.
And you'll be able to reach me.
Wonderful, wonderful. Thank you so much for being on the show.
And Dr. Moore, let me tell you, we have something in common. You grew up in Coweta. I lived in Coweta for several years, and I was born in Troup County, which is LaGrange.
That's right.
Yes.
Just
you
down.
Ever read the book? You ever read the book Murder in Coweta County?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, I remember
absolutely.
That. I remember yes. that. Just down the road from Columbus, Georgia, in Muskogee County, is your boy right here. So all this Georgia stuff going
fantastic.
On. Don't get it twisted now. Georgia run deep up in this piece. I know people say they come to Atlanta from everywhere, but a lot of us are already from Georgia, so don't get it twisted.
Absolutely.
Listen, this has been a lot of fun. We do this every now and then right here on Manifest TV, powered by Status Network. I'm going to need you to follow us on Instagram, manifesttv.status, Facebook, Status Network LLC, Periscope, Status_Network_, Twitter, Status_Network_. On the Amazon Fire Stick and Roku, it is Status Network or Manifest TV. And on YouTube, it's Manifest TV. I am Talk with Jeffrey, Jeffrey, on every social media platform except for Snapchat. I'm still not snapping, still not chatting. I don't get it. I guess I'm too old for it. It's been a lot of fun. I was a little rusty, but we still made it happen. We're going to do this again soon. I'll let y'all know when, but up until that time, I am out. Great show, great show, great show. Thanks.
Thank you.
Love you.
Now that you know about Jeffrey and Let's Talk About It Live, come be a part of our family.
You know we had to give y'all homework, right?
Keep up with the show. Follow us on all of our social media platforms.
That's Facebook and Instagram.
Would you like to listen to the show on the go?
Make sure you download the Status Network app on your Google or Apple Play Store.
Want to talk to Jeffrey?
Dial 470-251-4647.
We thank you for listening. And make sure you're back here
every Thursday
from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. on Let's Talk About It Live with Jeffrey L. Miller.
Status Network.